Yo guys, what's going on? The Card Guys here. Before we get into the top seven decks, you're probably going to see it, all your pro quests for season three. We want to announce something pretty huge. We are now partnering with Fabrek.gg. If you look right here on the screen, you'll see their website. Too many things to even talk about in this video, so we're going to actually make a separate video in regards to what the website offers and everything. A lot of things in the work with them, and we couldn't be more excited to work with such a credible company. So, if you guys can, leave a like, subscribe. Let us know if you like this style of video, something a little different than what we're usually used to doing. So yeah, hope you enjoy it. And these are the top seven decks that you should be expecting in ProQuest Season 3.
All right, before we jump into the list, we have one honorable mention, and that is Dorinthea Ironsong. I think this is a pretty good pick if you're very experienced with her, because she demands that your opponent knows how to play against her. If your opponent has no idea how to play against Dorinthea, it's basically a non-game. Also, Dorinthea has a lot of agency into most of the top tier decks. You can have a game against everybody. And I think there's a lot of important cards that she got recently that kind of push her over the line. Ironsong Pride is a extremely good card and can really snowball the game in the aggro matchups. And it also puts a lot of pressure on the slower decks as well, because oftentimes they spend the whole game trying to deny you one counter and you just get a counter for free, right? If you're good at playing Dory, if you know how to play her, I think she's a decent pick for this season of ProQuest.
Coming in at number seven for our ProQuest Season 3, we have Reinar. Reinar always will high roll and always does high roll. So it is the deck that nobody wants to see show up, but everybody should expect that shows up, because they got a lot of new tools like Savage Beatdown to hit you for 14 in the face while you have no cards in hand, which is pretty good. They also have just a lot of ways to make you unhappy. They also have quite a good Icelander and Dromai match, which we expect to see a lot of during the ProQuest season, and it's just coming off of a calling win in San Jose, California. So definitely a little bit more popularity for Reinar should definitely be expected this ProQuest season, and that's why we have it at number seven.
All right, coming in at number six is my main girl, Briar. The number one thing is going to be you have to look out for both varieties of the Belittle package and the Royal Briar, and then you also have just the regular CMH. The main decision point that the Briar players are going to be making is whether the Guardians are going to show up in the local meta, and that's going to dictate whether they go away from the Royal package or not. That typically does not do as well into those. So you have to be ready for both. And if there's a lot of Icelanders, they will be going into the Royal variety. And it always has the high roll potential of the deck as well, which is definitely something to look out for. And that's why we expect that to be a highly represented deck in this coming ProQuest season. And that's why it's our number six. Our number five on the list is going to be Old Man Oldham. All right. So we know that the Oldham players have to go very aggro, obviously, due to Dash and Dromai and everything. So they're going to have to bring their geriatric pommels, and they're going to definitely be disruptive with the Frost Fangs and everything like that. We're not really expecting them to slow the pace down and go like fatigue or anything, but just be ready for a very aggressive, presenting a lot of on hits. And that's why we think the fact that Oldham has all that agency on your turn with the ice reacts and everything, and of course Blizzard and Hypo, we think that it'll be a highly represented deck. And don't sleep on it. A lot of people lately have been saying that he's old news, even though he is old, but don't sleep on him and he'll be there. And that's why we have him at our number five.
Cheerio. Alrighty, coming in at number four, we've got Dromai, and just like the Illusionist class that people have come to love and hate, she offers the oppressive mechanic of just the fact that she can build up a base. She can control the board state, and if you don't respect that board state, then your bad decisions will end up costing you the match in the long run. She also can surprise you by being more of a Fi version of the deck, running things like Red Hot and going with wide attacks and the cheap dragons and just catching you off guard late game with suddenly, here's the dragons. And most importantly, she's a wizard and dash bully. If you show up to a ProQuest this season with Dromai, expect to see a lot of Icelander and a lot of dash, and you might just have a good time. And that's why we've got Dromai coming in at our number four.
Coming in at number three should be no surprise to anybody. It's the Ice Queen herself coming off of a world championship win under Michael Hamilton. I think the deck is solidified itself as one of the best decks in the format. It has one of the highest efficiency rates in all of Flesh and Blood, almost uncomparable. 2 for 4 is just, it's just good. Has a little bit of life gain and the most disruptive deck in the format. You can walk your life totals down with Icelander and lose the game every time if you do that. So you have to stay ahead of them, stay ahead of the curve, bring decks like Fi, bring decks like Dash, try to go fast if you're ready to beat Icelander. If you don't, the Ice Queen will take over the game and stop you in your tracks. That's why we have Icelander at number three.
All right. I'm not going to lie to you. There's a reason Fi is coming in at number two. Fi is a monster of a deck right now. He's the deck that you're going to hear the whispers around in your LGS halls. Like, have you guys heard? The new bully deck is Fi. Get ready to play your favorite deck and get beat down and have no fun because Fi is unfair. Let me tell you, Fi is not unfair, but we're going to use that to our advantage. You're going to sit down in front of your opponent and he's going to see Fi and he's going to quiver in his little booties and think, I can't win this match. This is the unfair deck of the meta. Also, Fi's explosive. He's got fun lines. If you sit down and you play Fi for a week, you're going to realize all the ways you can abuse Art of War, all the ways you can abuse Salt the Wound and Mask of the Pouncing Lynx. Fi is fun and Fi is consistent. And if you're a quick learner, you're going to learn him real quick for this Pro Quest season. Learn your matchups and learn them well, and Fi might just take you to the top. He's our number two.
And at number one, we have Dash. If you're coming into ProQuest Season 3, I think Dash has to be on your mind. There, what makes Dash so strong? Well, there are several plans for Dash. Dash can play a strong singular focus plan, either the Blaster Aggro or the Tree Frog style Dash, or even the Mechanoid Dash. Or if you want to incorporate two plans into one deck, you can also do that. You can have a switch style with Talishar plus a sideboard control package. Dash just has extremely strong cards at the moment, extremely well positioned, doesn't have a weak matchup except for maybe Dromai, has access to Pulse Wave Harpoon, one of the strongest cards of the game. And it's a deck that is not too mentally taxing to play, but it rewards those players with strong fundamentals. And I think it's definitely the top tier deck at the moment that you guys need to be aware of.
And that is going to be your top eight decks that you're more than likely going to see at the ProQuest Season 3. If you enjoyed the content, subscribe, leave a like, let us know if you enjoy this. We'll do more of this. Also, shout out to Fabrec.gg. They are, you know, the Flesh and Blood deck building site that has the most powerful search engine, and they had the latest deck list for the Fab World as well. If you guys enjoyed anything like this, definitely consider heading over to our Patreon. We have a very big community over there on Patreon with our Discord integration, and Josh just released his sideboard guide cards, actually, and we're actually working on doing that for every other big deck right now for this coming up season. So if you go check that out, you know, you'll have access to all of those sideboard cards. You can print out and have those in your deck box for each and every matchup going first and second. I think that's going to be something that a lot of people are going to love. Oh, we've already got good feedback from the Dorinthia one, obviously, because Josh is the Dorinthia guy. But yeah, like and subscribe. Hopefully you enjoyed this. And, you know, 2023 Flesh and Blood to the moon. We'll see you guys later.